and I want to actually personally thank every one of the speakers for coming in slightly under time, which gives us enough time for question and answers, which we will open it up now. So please, any questions for our speakers? Yes. But back, a little bit further back. Where's the microphone?
I see that you see only in one direction.
There we go.
I'm here.
Oh, over here. I'm sorry. the lights are, you know.
So good afternoon, everybody.
Please.
I see you know that here on the church, our audience here, better view with the comparison, you know, to your point. Anyway, good afternoon to everybody, and I have two questions. One question to everybody, or panelists. In your opinion, what will be a model of the future education in engineering? Because you are talking about the car business, about the, let's say, visualization, you are talking about the education. So anyway, everything, a background, it is in the education. So what's the future model of the education in engineering? And second question, which I have to all of the panelists, and especially to Professor Arturo Molina, because you are talking about the talents. So my question is, how to create human talent? Thank you very much.
Sure. Well, in terms of the model, I think it has to be appreciated that the basis of engineering is science and engineering science, and that's not going to go away. The students are still going to have to learn their math and physics and chemistry, and they're still going to have to learn their solid mechanics and deformable bodies and thermodynamics and all fluid mechanics and electric circuits and systems and all that stuff. That's not going to go away. And interestingly, another thing that's not going to go away or shouldn't go away is drawing. Engineering is basically a sport that's played with graphics. And in my estimation, any engineer who can't make a decent sketch with a pencil at a restaurant bar isn't worth a damn. And so I think that to a certain extent, the future of engineering education is very much like the past. In many of the basics, I think there. But having said that, I think that one of the things that we found from our study of skills needs in industry is that there's a much larger emphasis that needs to be placed on teamwork, on communication skills, written and verbal, as well as oral communications, ability to speak, and so on. And on just basic technical know-how, I think that modern young people are really good at computer type technologies. But for especially, I guess I speak for mechanical engineering. Most of them have never worked on any piece of equipment, and so when they sit down to design something, you see designs coming out which cannot be built, or at least cannot be built cost-effectively and cannot be serviced. And so it means that the task of educating the future engineer is going to become more complicated, because we have to do all the stuff we did in the past, but we also have to do a lot more to really prepare them for the workplace of the future. And at the same time, they have to learn about new materials and new manufacturing processes so they can get the best out of those new technologies for future products. So as Diane said, they're not designing composite parts that look like composite versions of metal parts, because those will not be optimal. And so it's a really tough task, but I think we just got to do it. I think maybe the program should move to 5 years, if I could put a plug in for that. In many countries it is 5 years. In some countries it's as little as three, and I don't see how they really can handle that effectively. I think experiential learning is important as well. I think students should absolutely spend time in industry. You don't learn that much about engineering hanging around a university, because most of the professors have never done any themselves. So I think really it's important to get out there into industry and get your hands dirty.
Do you want to add something? Okay, I will answer the second question, human talent. Well, I spoke about critical thinking, communication skills, and so on, but the most important C is what we call citizenship and context awareness. What is really important about that is that you always, a human, has to have a context, social context of where you are and what you're doing, and of course, act in terms of how is your relationship with the network and society you are in, and also about the importance of being a good citizen and also work with ethics. And that's the dimension I didn't mention because I didn't want to go into that level of detail in this presentation, but I think that that's the fifth C, citizenship, ethics, and of course, the context of awareness of a person who is working with other people. And I think that's a huge area where we are just learning about how to teach that and how you can put that in terms of educational models. For example, I just made the case of the challenge-based learning, where what you are doing, or we are doing at K-12, is that you are giving a challenge to a K-12 students, and they have to solve a community issue. But they just don't have to solve the problem, but they have to implement the problem, and they have to see if they have results. And that's working very well at K-12 level. I believe that if you do go that at the university level, if you have more social responsibility with this type of challenge, you could really have this idea of developing the human talent, which is more connected to people and your social network and so on.
I think these two gentlemen, I think the gentlemen were better experts to answer this question than me.
Good. Yeah, and I think just from the U.S. perspective, what we see is basically, and I agree with my colleagues here, you've got fundamental that you have to teach your students, and then you've got the what I would call the application. And really, you know, that application is going to be very different 5-10 years from now. Fundamentals don't change. The density of steel will not change over the next 100 years, more or less. You know, I think the only thing that's changed since I've been a student is electricity goes the other way now. It goes from minus to plus. But I think in what we see in terms of our verification and our standards within the United States is we see that they're becoming much more flexible and they're learning based. So the question is, you know, what does a student learn? How is a student able to learn and pick up? And that is very important. It gets back to lifelong learning. When those students graduate, they need to have the recognition, the understanding, and ability to continue to learn. And I think we saw that throughout all of the presentations. Good. We had another question over here. Yes. That was the question? No, that was already answered. Good. Yes.
Perhaps a couple of comments and then a question, perhaps. Of course, the world manufacturing, as was discussed today, includes everything from design to planning to manufacturing. This is interesting because we had a session yesterday as well. Is the sound okay? Yeah? Okay. It used to be that manufacturing is the word used in North America, and in Europe, they called it production, what we call manufacturing, and vice versa. But obviously, we're using the American terminology now for manufacturing. In terms of the skill, I agree with Peter that the basic skills are important. But in fact, in addition to that, what we call complementary studies or professional studies are very important as design and manufacturing becomes very complex. And maybe the 5 years would be a solution for that. But the other solution that kind of was not mentioned today is introduced by European projects also in the US and even industry, it's called the learning factories. Mm-hmm. So it's a big trend. And it's not the Penn State Learning Factory, which is essentially capstone projects that all engineering schools do. But it's a real factory within university setting, or also I visited a lot of companies that have it. Chrysler, for instance, in the US, they have the World Class Manufacturing Academy. That's a complete learning factory for all the skills. Scania in Sweden, the same thing, BMW started. They all, in industry, they started about 2 years ago. So it's another trend which is important, both at the universities as well as in industry. This replaced what industries used to do in the past, is to have a 2-year training program. So I think that's an important trend. But what is interesting about it, in addition to how to tighten bolts and nuts and the technical skills, there are a lot of skills relating to what I call management engineering or industrial engineering. Lean, teamwork, etc. is also included. But it's not sufficiently included in our engineering programs in general. And so this is strange, but this is what actually happens. The first time I visited China about 30 years ago, they didn't have a single industrial engineering department. Now they have about 40 departments. US also have industrial manufacturing systems. In other places in the world, including where I am in Windsor, industry tends to hire basic mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, even civil engineers, but they actually have to do industrial engineering work. One solution for that, which we are suggesting at the University of Windsor, but it's not implemented yet, is a program that includes both engineering and all the other subjects as well. It cannot be ABET or CAB accredited immediately, but I think it might be also for dealing with complex problems, you cannot solve them only using technical skills. You need all the other skills of not only communication and so on, but also teamwork, leadership, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm interested in the comments of the panelists on the place of industrial engineering, because even students don't know what it is, or what University of Waterloo called management engineering. It's the same thing.
So I mean, I can kick it off because, I mean, at least in the U.S., we have very large, I mean, if you go to Georgia Tech, we have one of the largest industrial engineering programs in the nation. So I think within the U.S., it's fairly well established. But I agree. If you take a look at the bulk of our engineers, our undergraduate engineers, they get their bachelor's degree, they go out, the bulk of them will go into, at some point in time, into manufacturing, you know. And so the question really is, how much can we teach them? You know, we only have 4 years. And the technology, as we've heard, keeps going up. My children always laugh because they say, well, history, you know, Dad, when you took history, it was much easier because there was so much less of it when you were a kid, right? So, you know, and that, but I think it's the same thing in terms of technology. So maybe we could have our colleagues here, you know, discuss, I mean, the fact that the information, everything that we want the student to know is expanding, but we only have 4 years or maybe 5 years. I know, Peter, you mentioned that already.
Well, we don't have that problem in Mexico. So, so we are four years and a half. Mm-hmm. But I believe that what you have to teach the engineers, you can teach them in 3 years. And the rest, it has to be the application. And the application is changing so fast that really you don't need the other 1.5 years. But what you have to do is give them different models to really... They have lifelong learning, like problem-based learning, case-based learning, you know, project-based learning, challenge-based learning. So other type of models where they can really have a, we call it the T, you know, the T educational model, when the bar of the T is the specialization. You have to be a good engineer, you have to be a good lawyer, you have to be a good business, and so on. And the soft skills are the top part of the T. So you have to have these five C's that we say, you know, critical thinking, communication, collaboration, creativity, and citizenship and context awareness. So you can do that in this time, then you have an excellent engineer, but right. Also a person who is for lifelong learning.
Yeah, I like my colleague's team model. I use the same in an expert organization in the same way. So there always is a difference between deep understanding of the basic phenomena. But then thinking engineering, you apply many sciences. Yes. You need to go over your comfort zone. And then have some level of understanding and, first of all, willingness to understand the other competencies in order to integrate them together with a proper solution.
Very nice. And Dr. Fries, we'll let you have the last word here.
Sure. Well, yeah, all of this was confirmed by the study that we did all those years ago. As I said, we surveyed about 55 companies across the country, and we actually surveyed mechanical engineering departments as well, But to be honest with you, I had civil engineers and electrical engineers comment on the survey, and they said the same things would apply to them. I don't recall if any of the companies, certainly not very many, actually made a complaint about this, the scientific level of knowledge of the students. It was all of the complementary skills, as Wagi says, the communications, the ability to handle a budget, understand a P&L type of spreadsheet, handle human resources issues, all those kinds of things that people have to do as they rise in a company. But having said that, we segregated the survey into brand new graduates, 5 years, 10 years, and I think 20. And what the company said was that as people go through their career, they will generally be provided with training in some of the more specialized aspects of those complementary skills as they rise within the company. And I think that, as Arturo said, there's only 24 hours in the day and we're already packing a lot in. And I think the students I feel they're just about at their limit of what they can absorb at this point. At least absorb effectively.
Good. All right, one more quick comment, sure.
May I make a small addition with a concrete example? A few years ago, we had a project together with two universities and one central hospital. That project included experts from machine vision to automation, remote control, biology, and toxicology. And the aim was to find a solution how to use machine vision to analyze cancer cells and inject new medicine to individual cells and watch how that injection has been succeeded and see how that affects the cell. And that required multiple disciplines. And when the machine vision expert started to speak like a toxicologist or biologist, I noticed something has really happened. And this I also would, I wanted to raise this example because that is something where we can create competitive advantage. That change is something you never can buy off the shelf. It is dependent upon the individual's willingness to go over their comfort zone in order to find a common solution. Thank you.
Very nice. All right, before I close, let me just remind you that we'll be back here at 16:20 for the last session of the day. And actually, we've talked about some nice policy, technology, education, and Dr. Van Boos and his team will actually talk about how we're going to fund it with venture capital, right? So I think that's going to be the more interesting part of the day. So please do come back here in about a half an hour. And let's once again thank our panel. Thank you very much, gentlemen.